Sir, your mic is mute, sir.
Yeah, so we were talking about trashing. So as far as trashing is going to be taken up, we will be using mostly for the page replacement content. So as far as trashing definition is going to be concerned, CPU is going to spend more amount of time in swapping, swap out operations at the page table. Rather than executing of a program, we are going to call the definition as a trashing, right? So the CPU job was bifurcated into two types. One approach, it has to execute the program. Second way, it has to swap in a page, swap out a page from a page table. So these two duties has to be done by the CPU concurrently. But most of the time, CPU was spending in swapping and swap out in a page table rather than executing of a program. We are going to call the definition as swapping. So we have a clear cut definition. The definition was CPU. It is going to spend much time in swapping of page table rather than execution. We are going to call that item as a trashing. Okay, then what was the solution towards that? The solution was to use a working set model. Okay, why should I use a working set model? The scenario what was raised was, if CPU is going to spend more amount of time in swapping rather than executing of a program, CPU utilization was so high and the degree of multi-programming was reached, but trashing is also very high. So this is an important observation what we have to make. So then CPU utilization is going to increase, degree of multi-programming at one level is going to fall, but still trashing is going to be very high. So that was the drawback, what is going to be identified, where this working set model is going to be elaborated. So as far as the working set model is going to rise, the reason was, we are going to say CPU utilization is going to increase and thereby trashing is also going to come into a scenario. Okay, so what was the second estimate of taking up the working set model? The second set of estimation was, we are going to say, as the number of page faults is going to increase, the frame size is low. But if the page size is going to be increased, then we can say the number of page faults is going to be low. So that means if I am going to increase the number of frames, then number of page faults is going to fall down. So this was important here. So in this scenario, we are going to take up this trashing was high. But in the second scenario, if the number of page frames are going to be increased, then the page fault is going to come down. That means if I'm going to take up the algorithm with the 20 frames, I'm fixing only the frame size as 3. If I'm going to increase it to 4, increase it to 5, that time the number of page faults will be reduced. So that is one more scenario where this trashing is going to be interpreted. Now, still, there was one drawback. The drawback what we are going to call will be a word called as some validity anomaly. The drawback, what we are going to assume was, it is going to be a word called as Velleday's anomaly. In this Velleday's anomaly, still there was a derivation that even though the number of page frames are going to be increased, but still number of page faults are going to be increased. So the graph what was proven here is again fault in a case called as Velleday's anomaly. So these are the two junctions where this working set model in caching has come into picture, right? And reiterating the definitions, etc. So caching, we are going to say CPU is going to spend much of a time in executing, much of a time in swapping and swap out of a page table rather than execution of a program. And second scenario, CPU utilization is going to be increased, degree of multiprogramming is going to be increased, and caching is going to be increased. That should not happen. Caching should fall down. The solution was, if we are going to increase the number of frames, definitely page fault will be reduced. If we are going to increase the number of frames, that is 1 to 5, see here the graph is going to show the number of page faults are going to be reduced. Okay, that was the solution proposed. But still, there was an error which was found by Velleday and hit that mistake. We are going to call it as a Velleday's anomaly. Here in this anomaly, it was pointed out, even though the number of page frames are increased, page faults are not going to come up. So to fix a solution, they went for a model called as working set model. They went for a model called as locality of reference. They went for a model called as locality of reference. So locality of a reference is a reference where the number of frames they are going to be pulled out. Then where the number of frames are going to be available, we are going to call that as a locality. So in which process number of frames are available, in which memory block number of frames are available, we are going to find it out. So that finding area, that finding zone, we are going to call it as locality of a reference. So where exactly these frames are going to be organized, which memory block, which memory disk is going to be identified, here we are going to identify a locality of reference. In locality of reference, we are going to build up this model, and the name of a model, we are going to call it as working set model. Fine. How is this working set model derived? The working set model, it is going to be derived with a word, called as delta. With a word called as delta, and it is going to be computed, over the time. It is going to be computed over the time, right? So we will be taking one certain time interval. In that certain time interval, how many number of frames are there? Again, we will take one certain time interval. In that certain time interval, how many number of frames are going to be taken? So that is how we are going to solve the word called as locality of reference in the working set model. So to identify a time interval, what is the constituent we are going to compute? The constituent we are going to delta will be a delta, and it is going to be represented over time, that is time interval t1, time interval t2. So assume that I am going to fix up to here. Assume that I am going to fix up to 1. So I can say time interval t1, what are the most frequent page frames in time interval t1? Identify most frequent frames. Identify the most frequent frames. So what are the most frequent frames? I can get 1, 2, 5, 6, and 7. So if I am going to constitute a page size as 5, if I am going to constitute the number of page map type with frames as size, then there won't be any page faults. Problem is solved, right? So I'm going to take up one locality in this locality, what are the most frequent items? So most frequent items are 2, 1, 5, 7, 6. So if all those I am going to put it into the page say, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, if I am going to put it as a page table size, then obviously the number of page faults will be reduced and the value becomes 0. Obviously, the number of page faults will be reduced and the caching will not happen. Why caching will not happen? CPU spends much of the execution in swapping rather than execution. That means there is no question of swapping, swap out. There is no question of swapping, swap out. Only CPU will concentrate on execution. Therefore, caching is going to be eliminated with the help of working set model and with the help of locality of reference. So that is what the solution they have proposed. Now let us estimate a time zone. Let us estimate a time zone here and conclude one more interval and conclude one more interval. So delta time interval T2. Then if I am going to conclude delta time interval T2 in this range, so what is the set of frequent items which are more frequent? Then it is going to be item number 3 and item number 4. So you can observe that only 4 and 3 are going to be iterated. Only 4 and 3 are going to be the most frequent items. So you have to compute between time interval T1 and T2 and you have to identify the most frequent items. What are the most frequent items? I'm going to set up 4, 4, 4, 3, 4, 3, 4, 4, 4. So in these items, what are the most frequent items? The most frequent items is 3 and 4. Now, what is the page table size? Because I'm going to have frequent items as only 2, now the page table size will be only 2. So in this way, the locality of reference, the working set model is going to be derived. In this way, both the items are going to be derived. Okay, fine. Now, what are the things we have to identify? What are the things we have to identify? So I have to compute delta. So there are two conditions for delta. That is, if it is too small, not if it is too large. If it is too large, it has to go for paging and it has to go with caching. And if it is too small, then the page table is optimal. So we are going to take up two scenarios where it is going to be too small, where it is going to be large. So when it is going to be too small, page table need to be added with frame. Page table need to be added with the frame if delta was too small. If delta was too large, obviously it has to join one more process and it should get paging and it should go for caching. So all that activities are common. Therefore, we are going to compute delta. How we are going to compute the delta? We are going to take up the working set model. How is working set model derived? It is derived from locality of reference. What is locality of reference? It is some set of frames which are pulled together in a memory block. Then, how I am going to compute a working set model? I am going to compute it with the delta over time intervals. So, I am going to take up one range. What is the name of range? We are going to call it as locality of reference. Then, how I am going to identify? I am going to identify a delta and I am fixing up with some range and whatever items are going to be frequent, those items I am going to pull up and thereby I am going to fix the number of frame size. So, in this, what are the most frequent items I am going to identify and I am going to pull it up. So, that is where we are going to compute the page table size. So, this is 1 and this is 2 and how I am going to compute delta. So, delta is going to be sum of working set model times with respect to locality of reference. How I am going to calculate the delta? Delta it is going to be sum of the working set items, that is time interval T1, time interval T2. I am going to pull it up and thereby I am going to get the answer. Okay, I got the answer. Now there are two cases. Whether data is correct, nothing will happen. Whether data is too small, what should I do? You increase the page table size. What should I do? You increase the page table size. If the sum of working set model is less than the optimal value, you just increase the page table size. Okay, then what happens if it is too high? If it is too high, you have to go for caching. There is no other alternative. So we are going to look up into delta. If it is too small, go for addition. If it is too large, go for caching. You told small, you told large. If it is optimal, then there is no question of paging. If it is optimal, there is no question of caching. Okay, how can I find the optimal value? Yes, you can find the optimal value. How to find it? You are going to take number of frames. You are going to take number of frames. The things which are too high, you are going to put it into upper bound. The things which are too low, you are going to put it in lower bound. Now you are going to get a scenario, what will be the optimal value, right? So if I am going to take the base cycle, which is between upper bound and lower bound, obviously the number of page frames will be very optimal and there is no question of caching. And there is no question of caching, right? So I am going to take up working set model, thereby building locality of reference. After building locality of reference, I am going to compute the delta. Delta I am going to build it up with time interval T1 and T2. I take some set of instances, get a value, get another value, make up a sum. If the sum is too high, add frames. If the sum is low, then go for caching. How to know it is optimal? You go for a graph. Draw the upper bound, draw the lower bound. So in between value, what we are going to get, that is what we are going to call it as an optimal value. So you pick up the optimal value for the page table. So that is what we are going to make a conclusion. Okay, then is there any direct relationship? Is there any direct relationship between page table frequency and working set model? Next question was, is there any direct relationship between this page table and working set model? Yes. Yes. Answer is yes. Because if I am going to draw a values for the locality of reference at time interval time 2 and time interval time 2, definitely it is going to give up the standard deviation model, that is a bell-shaped graph, and the items what we are going to take up, they are going to be in between the upper bound and lower bound. Okay, they are going to be in between the upper bound and lower bound. So in working set model, whatever items we are going to take from a delta, and we are going to measure the standard deviation. So it is going to get it over time in a working set model. The same set of items will be derived in this between upper bound and lower bound of the page fault frequency. Therefore, what was the conclusion? The conclusion was using working set model with the illustration of locality of reference will give a better solution for caching. Will give a better solution for caching. So we have in today's class, we have taken up a word called as caching. In caching, what we are going to define, a caching was CPU has two jobs. One job to execute a program, another job to swap out the page table. But what was the drawback? Much of the time, CPU is spending in exchanging of information rather than execution of an information. So that is the concept of caching. Okay, we got the definition. Now, how should I eliminate caching? You have to go for locality of reference and you have to go for working set model. What is locality of reference? It is some set of pools of memory segments where the number of frames are going to be allocated in the memory. So those are items we are going to take up. We are going to say locality. Okay, in that locality, we have to be in certain time interval. What are the most frequent frames? So that it is going to be built with a working set model. Okay, how can I build it? You have to build it with a word called as delta P over time. So I'm going to take a first reference between 2 to 5. All the items are pulled together. Now I got one slice. Next, I'm going to take another set of locality. In these most frequent items, I'm going to identify 3, 4. This is one locality. And I'm going to join it. That is, sum of working set models. We are going to represent it as delta. Okay, we got the delta. Now, what is the constraint? If delta is too small, I have to add frames. If delta is too large, I have to go for trashing. If it is in between, that is the better value. Getting a better value, we are going to call it as optimal. How can I know whether it is a better value or not? Then you have to verify it with working set model, and you have to verify it with page fault frequency. So page fault frequency, we say which is higher, which is lower. We are going to draw a graph that is upper bound and lower bound, and the things which are going to be in between, they are going to be the optimal value. The same optimal value which is raised will be re-evaluated in the working set model. That is, this bell shape, it is between the first boundary and the second boundary. Between these two boundaries, we are going to get the optimal values over time. So these values and the values raised by working set will be similar. Then we can say the set, it is going to be a good solution to solve the problem of traction. So that is all for unit 5. That is all for unit 5. So we have completed this unit. Now we will be taking up unit 6. So, unit 6, we are going to call it as file management and IO device management. File management and IO device management. The items what we are going to take up will be with file management will be, one will be the file concepts. It is going to talk about contiguous logical space. Second, it is going to talk about the nature, that it will be numeric, character, or binary. Then we'll be having some file type extensions, that will be name, followed by attribute, type, location, size, protection, time and date, direct dispatch. Next, we are going to have file operations. It is going to be some create, read, write, reposition, delete, open, close, followed by open files, going to talk about file pointers, and he is going to file open com. He talks about shape and execution. Now let us look into each and every item in detail, right? So in unit 6, it is going to be a composition of file management and IO management. So as far as files are going to be concerned, they are going to be sequential file and they are going to be a random access file, a direct access file. Sequential file, it is going to be a serial file that is accessible one after the other, one record after another record. We say it is a sequential file. But if the record is going to be handled random, then we are going to call that one as a direct access file. Now, how is this file organized? File is going to be organized with a set of serial memory locations. File is going to be organized with a set of serial memory locations, which we are going to call it as contiguous address spaces, which we are going to call it as contiguous address spaces. When we are going to be called as contiguous, they mean to be serial. Serial means it is one after the other. Roll number 1, 2, 3, 4. In this way, we are going to organize one after another item. Then we are going to say it is serial file. Now, say what values file will save. File is going to take up a file data. File is going to take up type data, and that type data, it can be numeric. It can be numeric. What is numeric? It can be integer value, or it can be boolean or float value. It can be an integer value, long int, short int, integer, or it can be a float value or a double value, a real number. Then we are going to call those items as numeric items. Second one, we are going to call it as string items, or we are going to call it as character item. So these items, they are going to be represented in bits, and they fall with one bit for each character measured in ASCII code. So we say it is character string. They are going to be measured in ASCII codes. So it is going to be a string of 8 bits. That string of 8 bits is going to be represented with this ASCII code. Next one, we are going to have the binary form. Then we are going to call it as a binary form. It is going to be in zeros and ones. If we are going to call it as a binary form, then it is going to be zeros and ones. So how is it data in file? Data in file, it can be strings, it can be characters, it can be numeric with integer or boolean, or it is going to be in form of zeros and ones. That is what we are going to call it as binary items. After that, we are going to have the file types. So every file is going to have some specific attributes for its unique identification. Every file is going to have some specific attributes for its unique identification. Okay, what are those attributes? The attributes, one, we are going to call it as file name. It is called as swap, it is called as factorial, it is called as Armstrong. So we call a file with a name as we have a name. Similarly, a file is going to have a name, and that is what we are going to call it as name. Then we are going to have the attribute, whether it is read, whether it is write, we are going to have some attributes for it. Next step, what type of file it is, whether it is .c, whether it is .java, whether it is .pdf. So what type of type the file is, we are going to take up. Next one, we are going to with location. Where was this file saved? Whether in a inode structure, whether it is in a supernode structure, in a C drive, in tree organization, in my documents, in desktop, where this file is going to be there, we are going to identify. That is what we are going to call it as size, followed by protection bits. So protection bits, they are going to give some valid bit and invalid bit so that the file is going to be secure from external references. So where we are going to call it as protection bits. After protection bits, we do have the file creation, modification, updation, so that it is going to be represented with a time, that is a date followed by time. Time is measured up to seconds, etc. So we are going to get this file size followed by which directory it is going to be saved. I create D drive, then I am going to call it as operating system, then I am going to call it as unit 1. So in this way, I do create it in forms of levels, in forms of directory structure. So which directory a file is going to be saved, that it is going to be taken up. Later on, what operations we can do on a file. What operations we can do on a file. The first and foremost, we are going to say it is opening up a file. The last operation, we are going to say it calls a close of a file. Between open and file, I need to know where exactly a file has to be created. So we are going to call it as creation of a file. File is created, file is opened, file is closed. File is created, file is open, file is closed. Between open and close, what will be the operations on a file? It is going to be a read operation, it is going to be a write operation, or it is going to be a reposition operation. It is going to be a reposition operation. What is reposition? Moving a file pointer from one location to another location, we are going to call that one as reposition. Opening a, the file pointer is at location number 5. Now I want to move it into location number 40. So moving from 5 to 40, we call that term as reposition. So moving a file from one specific location as source to a specific location called as destination, one place to another place, we are going to call it as reposition. Now, file has been created and the file is no longer needed, then we are going to make a delete operation. We are going to make a delete operation. Okay, so next comes what is open file. So I have my Windows desktop, I can open Word, I can open Notepad, I can open Excel, C, Java, Internet Explorer, browser. So in Chrome, any type of files I can open. So multiple programs are going to be run concurrently, parallelly, simultaneously, where the multi-programming objective is fulfilled. If the multi-programming objective is fulfilled, now list out how many number of files are opened. Where we are going to call it as open files, and the number of count, we are going to call it as open file count. So I opened 10 files, then the number of open files are 10. All the 10 files will have logical implementation, will have contiguous logical space in the memory, will have contiguous logical space in the memory. So we are going to call that one as open count. Every file is going to have a stack, and that stack is going to be allocated to each and every file in form of stack, heap, code, and data. It is going to be classified. We call that one as a file pointer. We call that one as file pointer. Okay, how are these files managed? Files are going to be managed One, we call it as shade, that is nothing but weed mode. Another, we are going to call it as weed or right, that is nothing but append mode. We are going to call it as append mode, and this append mode, we are going to call it as exclusive log. We are going to call that item as exclusive log. When we are going to make a write operation, when we are going to make a modification operation, alteration operation of a file, then we are going to call that one as exclusive mode. If we are going to make a read mode, anybody can do it concurrently in parallel simultaneously at a time, there we are going to call that one as shared mode. Fine, in shared mode, we can access a read operation. In exclusive mode, we can go for an edit operation, where we can make a write operations, right? So in today's class, we have taken up hashing, and hashing we have illustrated with locality of reference with working set model, and we have computed the value of delta, and thereby we proved that the working set model derivation is proportional towards the page fault frequency. After that, we have now talking about file management. In file management, we are mentioning about file concepts with file association in memory, file storage, numeric values, binary values, followed by character data, and file types. It can be C, it can be Java, and file names. As we have a name, files have a name, and file is going to be stored in a directory, location of a directory, when it was created, when it was modified, and all we call it as file types. On a file, we can create a file, open a file, close a file, reading a file, writing a file, deleting a file. These are the different file operations, and the number of open files are going to be calculated by the operating system to allocate the contiguous logical space, and thereby it is going to have two modes. One, it is going to have a read mode to make an exclusive operation, and it can be shared by multiple processes. But if it is going to be an exclusive mode, only write operation will happen. So that is all for today. Tomorrow you will be having another class at 8 AM, right? So stopping my recording.